Hello guys, Andrew again. I'm Andrew Steven Boyman. So today I've prepared a special lesson that I want us to talk about. And the title of the lesson is going to be What You Need to Know About Hackers and Hacking. I mean, first you might want to ask what hacking really is. Hacking, when discussed in the mainstream media, it simply refers to cyber thieves. But not all hackers are inherently bad. It depends, one, on how you use your computer skill to access information, what you use it for, and who do you use it for. So basically, I'll be reading to you my stuff that I prepared on hacking. Okay, let's start. First of all, as I mentioned, hacking itself can be a profession. But when you think about in the mainstream media, most people refer to hacking as cyber thieves. But I want to tell you today that it is not all hackers that do hacking negatively. We have some ethical hacking, which I will be talking about today, and I want you to know this because it is very important. I mean, we need to make the world secure. We need to make our friends around us secure in terms of using the internet or whatever social network they're using. So that's why I prepared this stuff for you. Now, hackers are generally categorized by type. We have the white hat hackers, the gray hat hackers, and the black hat hackers. Now, first, we're going to talk about the black hat hackers and what they do and why they hack. Like all hackers, black hat hackers usually have extensive knowledge about breaking into computer network and bypassing security protocols. They are also responsible for writing malware, which is a method used to gain access to systems. The primary motivation is usually for personal or financial gain. This is clear. The black hat hackers, they have extensive knowledge about computer and computing. What they do is they try to gain an unauthorized access into computer system or machine by bypassing all security protocols. Now, they do this basically for their personal interest or for financial gain. Black hat hackers are the one we are scared of or afraid of today in the world. Black hat hackers are the hackers we refer to as bad hackers. Black hat hackers in the mainstream media are the ones we refer to as cyber criminals. So beware of them. Secondly, we're going to talk about the gray hat hackers. As in life, there are gray areas that are neither black nor white. This is interesting. Gray hat hackers are a blend of both black hat hackers and the white hat hackers activities. Often, gray hat hackers will look for vulnerabilities in a system without the owner's permission or knowledge. So you see the difference here? Okay. If issues are found, they will report them to the owner, sometimes requesting a small fee to fix these issues. So the difference between the black hat hackers and the gray hat hackers is that the gray hat hackers, they are there to find vulnerabilities in system without the owner's knowledge or permission. And when they do, they let the owner know so that they can help them to fix it up for a small or a fixed amount. See? These type of hackers are not inherently malicious with their intention. So the difference is coming out that the black hat hacker, they do it intentionally for personal reason or financial gain, whilst the grey hat hackers, they are not malicious intentionally. But let's see, they just look to get something out of their discoveries for themselves. Clear? Usually, grey hat hackers will not exploit the found vulnerabilities. However, this type of hacker or this type of hacking is still considered illegal because the hacker did not receive permission. So, the grey hat hackers, if they found vulnerabilities in the system, they do not try to touch it, or they do not try to do some malicious acts with their discoveries. What they do is that if they are not willing to let you know that they've found this vulnerability in your system, they might just leave it like that and play around your network or your system and see what they can discover more. But yes, even though they are not doing some bad activity, it is also referred to as an illegal act because they are doing it without the permission of the owner or without the knowledge of the owner. Okay, so next we're going to talk about white hat hacker. Now, cyber security is a potential threat to those white hat hackers because every day, guys like us, I refer to me like us because are part of the white hackers. What we do every day, we try to find vulnerabilities with the permission and knowledge of the system owners. And we try to fight against the white hackers or the grey hackers. We can only do that if you authorize us to. Now, white hackers choose to use their powers for good rather than evil, also known as ethical hacking. Remember, I spoke about ethical hacking. White hat hackers can sometimes be paid employees or contractors working for companies as security specialists that attempt to find security holes via hacking. So, white hat hackers basically are there to mend the security problems of systems, accounts, computers, and they fix it up through the act of hacking. Why are they so special? Because they are all doing hacking. You be a black attacker or a grey attacker, we are all doing hacking. But why are we so special and we are legal as white attackers? This is simply because we use our knowledge in relation to the permission or knowledge of owners of the system in order to do hacking. And hackers, white hackers mainly can be specialists working for a company as a security specialist. Okay, so a few tips says white hat hackers employ the same method of hacking as black hats, with one exception: they do it with the permission from the owner of the system. So you see the difference? You being a black hat hacker or a white hat hacker or a grey hat hacker, we all use the same method. The only difference is that the white hat hackers do this through the permission of the owner of the system. Now, when we talk about hacking, I want to ask you a question. Have you ever done networking before? Or what is networking? You might want to say, no, I've never done networking before. But yes, you have. Networking simply, when we talk about it, means the interconnection of computer or device to share resources. So we have various kinds of networking and their protocols and topologies. Okay, I'll not go deep into that because I just want you to get the basic of hacking and to understand what hacking is all about. Now, But talking about networking, to assure you or to affirm or to confirm that one way or the other you've involved yourself in networking, you've done networking, let's talk about the Bluetooth. I know we've all used Bluetooth one way or the other to share resources, right? Okay. Now, Bluetooth is a telecommunication industry specification that describes how mobile phones, computers, and personal digital assistants, in brackets or the acronyms PDAs, can be easily interconnected using a short range wireless connection. One of the most commonly used networking apps in the world is Bluetooth. So you see, one way or the other, we've all used Bluetooth. We've all engaged in networking. Now, as for hackers, we also use Bluetooth to gain unauthorized access or authorized access to people's information. Know that one, you've done networking. Once you've done networking with somebody, the information in your device is no longer secure. So this is clear. I mean, Bluetooth is one of the simplest means or method used by hackers to hack people's information. Once you've done networking or share resources with anybody through Bluetooth, definitely know that or be assured that your information are no longer secure. Why? Let me tell you. So, one of the cheapest hacking tools we use to hack Bluetooth phone is the Bluetooth Share app that we download and install in our phones. We all know the Bluetooth Share app. Okay. And also, what we do, there is a software, there is an application app. I will not name it here right now. But once you install this Bluetooth app in your phone and share resources, I can use my device here to simply go through this application and view everything, each and every aspect of your phone, everything, every privacy, every document, contact, whatever you have in your phone. I will use this app to intrude or to view all those stuff in your phone. Now, I can copy, transfer, and delete using this app. So you see, one of the disadvantages of using Bluetooth or connecting with one another using Bluetooth. So now, shortly, I'm going to tell you, or we're going to talk about reasons why you should turn off your Bluetooth device after sharing resources. You already know that because of what I just mentioned about using the Bluetooth app to hack into your account. But if you can take notes, I'm going to give you those few tips. First, or number one, battery drain. One of the reasons, these are reasons why you should turn off your Bluetooth immediately after sharing resources with another person. Battery drain. Although Bluetooth is an energy effect technology, it does not slowly drain the battery of your cell phone or other mobile device. That's true. When enabled, Bluetooth continually scans for signal looking for new device to connect with, but using energy in the process. So, this is it. Bluetooth was built really in a way that it does not drain your battery, but if it is on, it continually scans, searching for new devices to be connected to. And this process, it uses energy, and this is how your battery can get drained. Also, number two, poor security. Virtually every network technology has some security built into it to prevent hackers from accessing your data without your permission. However, Bluetooth security is weak compared to Wi-Fi and other wireless data standard. The wireless fidelity is what they refer to as WIFI. A determined attacker can, for example, gain access to your wireless device through a Bluetooth connection, although he or she will have to be nearby and attempt to do this. But once you have shared resources with that person, there is no way we can say your account or your phone or whatever you're using is safe. Also, we talk about slow data. Most people use their phones or device when the Bluetooth is on to access the internet, and you might not notice it, but you see that your network connection is getting slower. One of the reasons is because of your Bluetooth device is turned on. Now, the tip here says, disabling Bluetooth when you are not using it improves security, as the connection can't be hacked if it is off. All wireless technology have limits on how fast they can transmit data. Generally, faster connection means higher energy consumption. So you see, because Bluetooth is intended to be very energy efficient, it sends data relatively slow. But the Bluetooth 4.0 low energy standard at 26 megabytes per second is much more faster than the Bluetooth used to offer and suitable for occasional signalizing and small backup operation. However, Bluetooth is not suitable for faster technology such as Wi-Fi or USB. When your Bluetooth is on, it limits the speed at which your data per megabyte can run. So this is another reason why you should think of turning off your device, your Bluetooth device, when not using it. So let me just give you a summary of the tips I've given you above. Disable Bluetooth when you're not using it, improve security, that's one, as the connection can't be hacked if it's off, that's two. Another option to consider disabling is Bluetooth discoverability features. It sends identification signal to all devices within its range, essential inviting a connection. So by this, it uses energy, power, slow down your data, consume battery drain, etc. So I believe these few tips I've discussed here about Bluetooth, you take this into consideration and you'll be able to save your data, save you from hackers, and save your battery from getting drained, paired with accessories that may have been stolen to prevent thieves from gaining. See, you might want to turn off Bluetooth discoverability simply because you've already paired your device with other people and you might not want them to gain unauthorized access to your phone or even without your knowledge. So this is why you want to consider turning off your Bluetooth. Now, that was few talk on networking, so you can understand the basic of how it really works with hackers. Now, how to stop hackers from hacking you? This is a big question. How can you stop hackers from hacking you? First, we're going to talk about, let's say we do use social network almost every day. And we do use the internet, you check our emails, Facebook. I mean, these are all networking sites that can be easily hacked into your Facebook account, your email account. So now, how do we stop hackers from hacking our accounts, basically, or from hacking you? First, be suspicious of email. And yeah, with the like of Yahoo and Gmail, we've seen that when there is that amount of security in the Gmail system, when you receive email and new incoming email, if they are not really recognized by your networking security, they just transfer them into your spam account. But one way you can save yourself from hackers is to be very conscious of suspicious email. You know that you don't have any transaction with this person, you don't know this person, you have nothing to do with this person, and you are not even expecting any message from this person. Be suspicious of that person. Be suspicious of that account. Never, ever open it. Delete it immediately and don't try to open it in any way. Remember, the Black Hat hackers, who are the preparers of malicious substance, malware, sending to, they use these tricks to hack into your email account or to your account. Now, being suspicious of an email, what you need to do, go to the message, then you right click the option on the message, go down, you will see a menu of options. I mean, if we can take a look here, it's very far, you can't see this. But, okay, I'll just explain to you. Go down, now you will see reply forward filter messages like this. Print, delete this message, report spam, report phishing, show original, message text, garbled, translate message, mark as unread. Now what you need to do, if you are suspicious of this message, go down to show original. Click show original. After you click that, show the original to find the source of the email, where the source is coming from. A lot of cyber attackers are launched through a lot of cyber attacks are launched through simple malicious mail campaigns. Email is wonderful communication. We all know that it's a wonderful platform to communicate faster with thousands, millions of people within seconds. Okay? So, because you can send anything to anyone, but that means it can be huge risk also, yeah. It doesn't mean because you can send a message or anything to anyone, then you are like, oh, once message is in, you want to reply. No, be malicious of this account. Go to the email address. You right click, go to show original to test the original source of this email address or this account coming in. Now, if you do that, and the best way to avoid being scanned by phone emails to just secure sender's information to extract, you can check for the sender's IP address. Once you check the source of the incoming mail, check also the sender's IP address if it's real, or if the source is real, you then go on, do what you want to do, reply to the person. But if the source is definitely not real, I'm not telling you what to do, you know what to do. Okay. Another thing you need to do, check link locations. Now, every email you receive or you send has a link attached to it. What you want to do is that go to that link, check the link location. That will help you simply to use the Google search map of that link, and you know the source or if this location is real. Now, the TPR says unknown messages contain link to unknown sites, you see. So if this message is unknown and it's from attackers, it may contain a link from unknown sites. Definitely, once you notice that, know that they are trying to hack your account. Don't open that email. Okay. Suffering to a mysterious website can bring about unattended consequences for one. It could be mimic a site you know and trust, and you believe this site, yeah, I'm expecting this from the person here, you can access that. But if you at all don't trust this site, don't even guess of opening it. Another thing you should take into consideration is never open attachment unless you are really sure. Okay, this is the best way to get you being attacked. prepare the software, malicious malware, and package it well, just attach it to a message. Once you open this email and click the or download this attach material into your system, you are installing this malware into your system. By that way, hackers have already entered into your system without you even knowing what you've done to yourself. So never open any attachment unless you are sure of it. Another thing you need to take into consideration, especially for us using email every time to do our business and other important stuff, is to use the two-factor authentication process. Signing into or registering to Gmail, they will ask you for your mobile number and your email address. So when you want to log in again for security purposes, they might ask you for this email address and for you to prove that yes, this is real, this is my account, give your phone number also, so that they will send a confirmation code into your phone before you can access that account. This is very secure. And also what you need to take into consideration is like switch to the Google Authenticator app. When you're using Gmail, you go to where you have your apps, search for the Gmail, or you switch to the Google Authentication app. What you do is that you will see Android, iPod, BlackBerry, etc. You choose what you're using for this account and then you click continue. Now, another important stuff that I want to talk about is using advanced password system. How do we create password? How to create a secure password? How do you own one? A very secure password. Listen, I'm going to read this for you. This may be the most obvious yet outlook tip. A strong password include uppercase, lowercase, number, punctuation, and gibberish. Gibberish is like you preparing something or using symbol or very unusual code. Don't make the password a personal reference and don't store a list in a save file. Most importantly, do not use the same password for multiple accounts. There are some great tools like LastPassword and IP password that securely store password. Also, it is crucial to change password frequently, especially for vulnerable accounts like email and banking. See? Now, let's take this password usage into consideration. I'm going to read the how you create password, how you do to create password, a secure password. Password are simple and cheaper than any other thing, you know that. More secure forms of authentication like special key scan, fingerprints, ID machine, and rental scanner. They provide a simple direct means of protecting a system or account. For the sake of this article, we will define a password as a word, a phrase, or combination of miscellaneous characters that authenticate the identity of the user. Now, passwords are generally used in a combination with some form of identification, such as username, account number, or email address. While a username establishes the identity of the user for the computer or system, the password is known only to the authorized user. Authenticates that the user is who he is or who she is claims to be. This means that their function is to prove to the system that you are who you say you are. In bracket, Russell. This is interesting. Now, to create a password, you use uppercase, lowercase, gibberish, capital, I mean, symbols, whatever that will make the password very difficult for others to test. Let's talk about password cracking. Password cracking. While passwords are vital components of system security, they can be cracked or broken relatively easily. Password cracking is the process of figuring out or breaking password in order to gain unauthorized entrance to a system or account. It is much easier than most users would think. The difference between cracking and hacking is that codes are cracked, machines are hacked. So, the difference between cracking and hacking is that codes are cracked, like password are cracked, and machines are hacked. So that's the difference between hack and crack. Also, now, if you want to create a very secure password, it is very easy. How to choose a good password? Now that we have established the importance of password and some of the ways in which they might be vulnerable to cracking, let us now discuss how we can create a strong password. First, no dictionary word, proper noun, or foreign word. No dictionary word, proper noun, or foreign word. No dictionary word, no proper noun, or foreign word. Just use any word, but there might not be a dictionary word. As I've already been mentioning in the password stuff, password cracking tools are very effective at processing large information. Now, if you use the dictionary, if you use dictionary word as your password or pronoun word, what hackers do with password cracking software? Once this password cracking software is being launched, it runs series of process searching the vocabulary of dictionary, the vocabulary of proper noun, and they are very effective to do this. One way or the other, they might just tap and get what they are looking for and access your account. So that's why I'm advising you not to use dictionary word or proper noun to create your password. Secondly, no personal information. Like we create password, say you use your name and number. No personal information. One of the frustrating things about password is that they need to be easy for users to remember. Naturally, this leads many users to incorporate personal information. I know because of we always want to remember our password easily. We do use personal information that will enable us to gain access easily or to remember this password, but don't use personal information. Now, to create a very good, secure password, we're going to talk about three things: the length, the width, and depth of that password you're creating. A strong, effective password requires a necessary degree of complexity. Make it very complex that even if hackers are trying to hack your account, it will be very difficult. The three factors can help users to develop this complexity. That's what we're going to talk about now, the length, the width, and the depth. Let's talk about the width of the password. Width is a way of describing the different types of characters that are used. Don't just consider the alphabet. There are also numbers and special characters. So the width is talking about what you use, the numbers, the letters, the character, the alphabetic, what we use is what we refer to the. Now, how to use this? We use uppercase letters such as AB, capital ABC, lowercase letters such as ABC, numerical such as 123, special characters such as the dollar sign, the question mark, the and sign, and other characters such as the alter characters such as the dollar sign, different kinds of sign. When you use this, it makes the password to be very complex for hackers to hack easily or to break easily. Now we talk about depth. Refer to choosing a password with a challenging meaning, something not easily guessable. Stop thinking in terms of password and start thinking in terms of phrase. Now, the depth of the password creating process is talking about use what you use to create the password. Don't use personal information, your name, dictionary word. Make sure that the password, the word, is not even a word. Use a phrase to create this password so that it's not easily guessed by hackers or others. Also, let's talk about we've talked about the depth of the password and the width of it. Now the length is very important. The length is how long your password is. And there was a time I had to use somebody's machine and I typed in my password to log into my Gmail account. The person was like, wow, this is crazy, because my password, the length of my password was so long, was so lengthy. I did this because of the security reason, but she might not know. At that moment, I told her this is the reason, and she was okay, I'm going to implement the same thing. So likewise with you, when creating a strong and secure password, think about the length, think about the depth, and think about the width of that password. Now, I prepared a very short tip here for organization. I'm going to read this out. My recommendation to organization, tips for organization and network administrator. Managers and administrators can enhance the security of their network by setting strong password policy. Password requirements should be built into organizational security policy. As an organization, because of the cybersecurity now in the world, I'm encouraging you all, administrator, organization, network administrator, that password security should be built in your policy. When